celebrate by seeing the growth of NAM as a think tank institute. Our staff and we ourselves are preparing in this. We started preparing, but we are enhancing our competencies towards the think tank institute of the country in agriculture ICR institutes. Transforming this is the idea came from NITI Aayog when 2017-18 when EFC was presented. And again, here is a challenge. Basically, we want the growth of NAM. The thing we are all such a big mega organization. Basically, we are self-preparing in this. We are training in this. We are training and training our clinicians. The thing that the Eastern Mahatma is in every very well, outstandingly well. Our staff are doing great job. In fact, they are which is meeting was attended by and Honorable President of India. And NAM received Best Landscaping Award from Government of India. NAM has been transformed not only the quality of research policy and trainings, but academy is look like a foreign university now. The academy physically, lot of infrastructure, landscapes were that is witnessed by the Telangana government of our meeting was attended by landscape and Honorable President of India.
Contributed to the
and supporting Nam received government in the landscaping of centers from government of India.
In Hyderabad,
it has in Nam has been transformed to say that sir, the quality of research,
March 17th and trainings
when law academy is looking like a foreign university now.
23rd onward, the academy physically
lot of infrastructure
lands the Nam that is provided to
the Telangana government
of India.
Facility. In fact, this will be a supporting system whenever something happens in main center at Delhi. So data recovery is possible. Though all 70 years of our ICR data is very securely built in here. We also thankful Honorable Minister Narendra Singh Tomarji, who physically visited our academy. He addressed Indian Forest Services 80 probationers and motivated them.
In fact,
the service will be a supporting system whenever something
and
happens in
recently
main chairman in Delhi. So data recovery is possible. Chindala,
though all 70 years visited
our ICR data is
that we have very securely
built in.
Sir, yes.
we are really
thank very honorable minister Narendra Singh Tomarji,
several physically
visited our Delhi
academy
29
Indian Forest Service
80 probationers
and motivated them.
In fact,
the service will be a supporting system whenever something happens in
main
chairman in Delhi.
So data recovery is possible.
Though all 70 years visited
our ICR data is
that we have very securely
built to here.
We are really
thank very honorable minister Narendra Singh Tomarji,
several
physically visited our Delhi
academy
29.
academia, industry, subsequent years. So it is all typical reflection of the academy, how high performing as a academy. Our DG, Dr. Mahapatra ji, tells that the EOG is very, this agriculture academy is a transformed academy now. And Dr. Katiyal, former DDG, says that academy is for everything. Entire mandate
subsequent years.
Any mandate,
so it is all typical reflection of the academy.
The confidence we will be able to grow by the agriculture academy. I am sure our team will serve to the as a farmer and society that in coming years. YouTube is I think it is directly telecasted. Thank you very much, and thank you very much for your strong support, and congratulations to entire NAM staff, NAM family, and
people in the high dignitaries in the audience, the Honorable Deputy Director General Dr. Agrawal, the Honorable Director of this Institute, Dr. C.S. Srinivas Rao sir, the former directors of this Institute, which I see in the audience, Dr. Joshi sir, Dr. Ramarao sir, all the directors of that various ICR institutes, all the heads of the divisions of NAM, the faculty, staff, officers of NAM. First of all, from my own side also, congratulations to all of the staff for on this 45th Foundation Day of the Academy. And I'm really fortunate to introduce to you Dr. R.S. Parodha. Though Dr. Parodha does not need any formal introduction in this, he's a renowned agriculture scientist. Dr. Parodha is a chairman of Trust for Advancement of Agriculture Sciences, TAS. Very popularly it is known as TAS and located at IARI at New Delhi. He's a highly reputed, very renowned, internationally renowned plant breeder, and he joined ICR as a director of NBPGR. Later, he rose to the position of Deputy Director General Crop Sciences, and then the Secretary of DAIR, Government of India, and the Director General of ICR. After ICR, then he had many other responsibilities with the various governments of various states, like Farmers Commission Chairman of Haryana and other states also. And he also served as a boards of different international organizations and serving also, like IRRI or ICRISAT and several other organizations. Every one of us knows that he's a great institutional builder. Our director said that NAS, yeah, he's the chief architect of that that facility, which in-houses not only the guest house, but also the top international organizations. So now that location is on the international map, actually, that particular location. And many of us and all of us knows that he is the one who initiated National Gene Bank, and which is the facility of this nation contributing to the country and also internationally. In addition to that, he has created more than 30 research institutes during his regime as a DGICR and secretary there. And other than this, two very, very important international organizations which he has created. One is GFAR, a global facility, GFAR of FAO, and then APARI, that is Asia Pacific organization. So these two organizations, and in fact, he was the one who is the chief architect of these two great organizations, which are serving greatly for the germplasm. Recognizing his contribution, professional contribution, several awards he has received, ICR award, top ICR awards, then awards of other organizations, national organizations, international organizations. He got like Borlaug award, and also several awards by several governments internationally too. He is a selected fellow in various academies like NAS, NASI, INSA, and other international organizations, not only here in India, but also abroad, like he is a fellow of Third World Academy of Sciences, Russia, which is a very, very popular academy, we call it TWAS. He was selected as a general president of Indian Science Congress during 2000 and 2001. So that was the very, very, very high recognition to any agriculture scientist, and through him to all of us. Dr. Parodha has been given as honorary doctorate by around 20 universities in India and abroad. And more than that, Dr. Parodha is one of the most wonderful human being. I have seen personally that he was so accessible to all the staff of ICR when he was the director general of this great organization. And he is one of the most wonderful administrator. And we are lucky. We always had the blessings from Dr. Parodha. This time, because of COVID, we are talking distantly. Otherwise, he would like to come to NAM, and he has come to NAM many times. Sir, once again, from my side also, again from the NAM side also, welcome to this particular day. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Now we'll move on to the next event, that is release of NAM publication. To do the honors, I request our chief guest to kindly declare the book released. We have made a book on HRD units at a glance from ICR. So on
with the permission of the chief guest, Dr. Padma, Dr. R.S. Baroda, the book is being released. Thank you so much, sir. This is a compilation of the entire, all the ICAR institutions, HR units, a comprehensive account on the training needs, the details of the HR nodal officers of all ICAR units. And this is authored by a team headed by Dr. Alok Kumar, faculty member here. Next, we proceed to the very, very important annual event, annual awards of the Academy. As all of us know, like the Academy has a tradition of honoring its staff members under various categories for their distinguished performance, outstanding contributions. So we have broadly six categories. One, the best employee of the decade for various categories of the staff, and then best performer award for the last year, and special recognition awards for the outstanding contribution for specialized tasks of the Academy. And this year, as Director rightly mentioned, like to recognize the special contribution of the staff members towards during the pandemic, a special award has been constituted. And we also have almost a dozen farmer friends who have joined us, who have been identified from across the country as innovative farmers. I request the chairman, Dr. R.S. Parodaji, to kindly declare the annual awards for the NAM. Request your permission, sir, please.
My pleasure.
Thank you so much, sir. And so now, with the permission of the chief guest, on behalf of the chief guest, our director will give away the first category of the awards, Best Employee of the Decade. I call upon Dr. Vijayendra Reddy, who backs this award under the technical staff category. Next, I request Dr. Vani Shri, who backs the award under the admin and finance staff category. The skill supporting staff, the best employee of the decade award goes to Srimati B. Shantamma. She is currently with the library section. The award for the best employee of the decade under the casual laborer with the temporary status. The award is to Sri B. Raju, Farm Section. Thank you so much, sir. Recognizing the pressure of time in a virtual program, the other awards will be declared now, and the participants will be distributed the certificates at the end of the event by director in front of his office. So the annual awards, the best performance during 2019-20 among the faculty, the best scientist award is to Dr. S. Senthil Vinayagam, principal scientist and head ESM division. Best faculty award, all of us know, like we have the PGDMA program, and for the teaching category, best faculty award to Dr. Ranjit Kumar, principal scientist and head ABM division. Another core activity of our the academy, that is capacity building, the best trainer award goes to Dr. P. Krishnan, principal scientist, RSM division. second category of the best performance for the last year under the admin staff officers category, the award is to Mr. Z.H. Kilji, Chief Finance and Accounts Officer. Admin staff non-officers category, Mr. R. Chandrababu, Assistant in our office. Technical staff officers category, Dr. K.V. Kumar, Chief Technical Officer. Technical staff T1 to T5 category, the award is to Mr. ACPRN Rao, Technical Officer. The annual awards for support staff and then CLTS. Among the skilled support staff male category, we have the award for Mr. S. Venkatesham, the library section. And skilled supporting staff female category, Srimati I. Bharatamma from the farm section. Another CLTS male, the award is to Sri N. Yadagiri. National labor with the temporary status female, the award is to Srimati M. Lakshmamma, farm section. The academy has a tradition of recognizing the contribution of the faculty members and all the officers and staff members across various specialized tasks associated with the academy. The award for the outstanding contribution for the overall institution building, that's for Dr. M. Balakrishnan, Principal of the Scientist, ICM Division. The award for Swachh Bharat Abhiyan of the Academy, the annual award that is for this year, it is to Mr. Dhanam Murari, Technical Assistant. We have a novel award recognizing the role of the Academy to be a leader and then a model for the rest of the institutions under ICR, Energy Conservation Award. And this year, the award goes to Mr. K. Shivaya for his contribution towards this effect, Technical Officer. As our director rightly said, like during the pandemic, the Academy had to sustain a large, diverse kind of activities, research, teaching, and the capacity building. And to this count, the support that was provided from all the support sections, technical, supporting, CLTS, admin, and then finance had been monumental. Like, and even during the peak period of lockdown, large number of staff members representing from this group, they reported to office truly risking not only their life, even their family members. So everyone who reported to office during this period truly is a COVID warrior. The Academy recognizes it. And just as a mark of respect of the Academy to this support team, the representatives from each category is being given a special award for this. So from the technical staff T6 and above, the recognition is to Mr. M. Shekhar Reddy, ACTO. Technical staff T1 to T5, recognition goes to Sri T. Lakshman, Technical Officer. And among the admin and finance team, Srimati Y. Gayatri, UDC. Recognition under the COVID warriors, skill supporting staff, there is Sri C. Venkatesham, currently is with CFF section, and under the CLTS category, Sri K. Shamlu, farm section. Again, we thank on behalf of the Academy to all the COVID warriors who contributed enormously, and they are also set to contribute in the coming times ahead. Like, congratulations to all the award winners. And we have one special felicitation for the farmers. As all of us know, like NAM is the project management unit for the ICR's Farmer First program, wherein we network with almost 51 ICR institutions spread across 11 agroclimatic zones. So every year we recognize the farmers, innovative farmers from each agroclimatic zone as per the nomination from the respective networking partners. So this year we have 11 farmers representing 11 different agroclimatic zones, and they have all joined us virtually under this program. We recognize their presence and then share our compliments and then wishes. So the first, sorry, just 1 minute. From zone one, we have Shri Mehar Singh Sindhwan. He is from a village near Dehradun, Uttarakhand, and his contributions are related to cultivating high yielding varieties of field crops, and he has also been cultivating medicinal and aromatic crops, and he has been a source of motivation to the farmers to take up soil and water conservation and integrated farming system in his region. Second, from zone two, we have Shri Ram Bhagat Pangal. He is from a village Bure near Hisar, Haryana, and he is recognized in that region for adopting bed planting technique in wheat. He used a supplementation of manure mixture which increased the milk yield, and he has been a source of inspiration for the farmers for integrating farming system in that region. From zone three, we have Shri Anil Singh. He is from Paniyara village in Varanasi, UP, and he is engaged in cultivating vegetables along with high yielding varieties of wheat and paddy, and he maintains a kitchen garden which is kind of a model for the people who are living around him. Like, from zone 4 we have Shri Tulsi Matho. He is from a village near Ranchi, Jharkhand, and he has been a farmer who has been promoting desi goat, and he has been motivating the farmers in rearing Bengal goat and buck with scientific care and management, like balanced feeding, hygienic house management, vaccination treatment, all that. He has been a source of inspiration for all the farmers around. From zone 5 we have Shri Shiba Narayan Samal. He is from a village near Cuttack, Odisha, and he is engaged in cultivating commercial hybrid vegetables, and he produces vermicompost, and is also engaged in commercial mushroom cultivation, dairy farming with Jersey cows. From zone 6 we have Shri Mrs. Jyoti Sonowal. She is from a village in Assam, and she follows relay cropping in rice fallow, engaged in vegetable cultivation, poultry and pig farming, and improved method of compost production. She is also involved in mushroom cultivation, egg hatching and sale of portable incubator. From zone 7 we have Shri Mrinal Chokwai. He is from northeast in a village from Meghalaya, and he grows paddy, vegetables and spice crops, rears local pigs for fattening purpose, and he has converted his pig farm to a pig breeding unit to meet the high demand of improved breeds of piglets, and he has been a supplier for the piglets as well. From zone 8 we have Shri Rakesh Kumar Chaganbhai Vaksia. He is from Amreli, Gujarat. He grows cotton crop with drip irrigation. He has adopted close planting and detopping practices, and he is engaged in disseminating information to other farmers on all the various farming practices he has been engaged in. From zone 9, we have Shri Bharat Patel. He is from a village in near Panagar, Jabalpur. He is engaged in rice cultivation, short duration YMV resistant green gram and black gram. He has been practicing zero tillage sowing of improved variety of wheat, and he has undertaken mushroom cultivation and then vermicompost production. From zone 10, we have Shri Brother Veer Shetty. He is from a village as state Sangarendi district, and he is providing millets processing facilities on custom hiring basis to all the farmers nearby, and the fellow farmers are getting motivated towards millets and allied farming, and he is recognized widely by the various agencies in the government. From zone 11 we have Shri Gopalakrishna Pillai from a village in Kerala, Alappuzha district, and he introduced cow mat in cattle shed to reduce laming, and he is involved in value addition of milk, and he is also engaged actively in IFS with organic vegetable cultivation, fish pond and various other IFS components. So we take this opportunity to place the appreciation of the entire academy and then ICR for all the farmers who have been represented from the entire country. Thank you all for joining us virtually. So now with all the awards have been declared, we shall have the pleasure of listening to our chief guest, Padma Bhushan, Dr. R.S. Paroda, former secretary, DAIR and DG ICR. And he is to give his foundation lecture on NAM, a think tank for reorienting Indian agriculture. I request Dr. Paroda, sir, to please continue. Sir, thank you.
Thank you. Are you able to listen to me and also watch me? Is it okay? I'm fine.
Then. Yes.
Yeah. Well, Dr. Srinivas Rao, Dr. Som, Dr. R.C. Agarwal, Dr. Pramod Joshi, Dr. Amarao, many directors of ICR institutes attending this Foundation Day function today, faculty members, many farmers, students from the management schools, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, it's a great privilege for me to participate in your Foundation Day. This is not first time. I think maybe I can't count them, but recently I had given when we were reviewing ASRB a few years back, also the Foundation Day, it happened to be on that day itself. So my full appreciation for what this institute has become over the last 44 years. This is 45th Foundation Day. You deserve all appreciation, and those who have received decade best technical and administrative staff like Vijender Reddy and Vanishi deserve my special appreciation. Also appreciation to Dr. Srinivas Rao for receiving this year the prestigious ICR Rafi Ahmad Kidwai Award. It speaks volumes in the sense that all faculty members are fully committed to serve the cause for which this institution was established on this day in 1976. The institution has grown. It has almost matured. One generation has served the national system. I understand Dr. Pramod Joshi and Dr. Ayappan were the first batch of ARS, and they have retired, and it's the second generation being trained. So Dr. Mahapatra is now another product leading the national system today. So the institution today has a lot of laurels on which it can be proud of. And it has grown and matured in many ways, about which Dr. Srinivas Rao very clearly explained and highlighted various achievements. So having said this, I would like to say that this institution also having best possible ambience in terms of its infrastructure, its environment. Even when I had been to NARM last 3 years back, I decided to go along with my wife on a vacation and spend a few days there on the campus just to enjoy the environment, and the environment which in current time of COVID, any would crave for it. And therefore, all the faculty members and the staff who are working and living there on the campus really are fortunate to have this kind of opportunity in today's time. The institution was served so well by very distinguished people and eminent leaders like Dr. Anant Rao, Dr. K.V. Raman, Dr. K.C. J.C. Katyal, Dr. Pramod Joshi, and many others, Dr. Rama Rao, and we have to appreciate what they contributed to the system. Success of building competent human resource through the cadre of ARS is itself a unique achievement. It started with the institution of Agriculture Research Service, which gave prestige to the agriculture scientists and to our entire community. And this started in November 73, when ASRB was also created under the leadership of Dr. M.S. Swaminathan, and Dr. Sahari was the first chairman, thus benefiting by now, as I understand, more than 40,000 stakeholders have been benefited in one way or another by being on NARM campus and attending its various programs, including the foundation program. Importance of institutional and human resources become evident as an important cradle of success. While we achieved green, white, blue revolutions, I once asked Dr. Borlaug, after Green Revolution and after 20 years of his work in Africa, I said, can you define the cradles of success of Green Revolution in India, which you don't seem to be finding in Africa? And his reply was, first, the political commitment and will that you have in this country is not visible there. Second, the institution and human resource. And institution like IRI, because the seeds of Green Revolution were sown at that time when I started my career as a, or rather started learning agriculture as a PhD student in mid-60s. And that's the period when we worked with Dr. Swaminathan and Dr. Borlaug. And I happened to be working on wheat crop, had an opportunity to see how we could accomplish those achievements. So from begging bowl to self-sufficiency, we have been able to have six-fold increase in food grains. You all know about it. I don't have to take more of your time for this. Despite four-fold increase in the human population, on demographic front, we have still a bigger challenge. Almost 16 to 17 million people we are adding, almost one Australia every year. But at the same time, in agriculture, thanks to this revolutions, that we could not only become self-sufficient, but become an important exporter of various agricultural commodities, including even the food grains. And today, we are exporting to a level of about $40 billion, and have in our buffer stock maintained for last almost a decade, somewhere between 40 to 50, 55 million tons of food grains, which is indeed a remarkable achievement from ship to mouth to level of self-sufficiency and the kind of growth which we have maintained between 3 to 4% is also to be recognized. It is not easy. And this growth had been much faster in other sectors like horticulture, 6 to 7%, in case of milk, almost 8%, and in fish, almost 11%. And today our horticulture production has surpassed even food grains. Milk production, we are number one in the world with 188 million tons. And in fish, from hardly 5 million tons, that too mainly from marine, which has declined almost by half now, but our fish production has increased through inland aquaculture, thanks to the science, thanks to again the development efforts, that today we have 12.6 million tons of fish production, and we are a major exporting country. In this context, we must also realize that though there are other sectors which are contributing to national GDP, agriculture is still contributing about 15 to 17%, which is quite a remarkable achievement. And thanks again to the policymakers for having created the infrastructure for having strengthened the national agriculture research systems, the system like what we have, the National Agriculture Research System of India. It started with NARI actually to begin with. And if I come to that, I will give you some idea about it later. But Indian NARS has evolved as one of the strongest national agriculture research system in Asia Pacific region. As executive secretary of APARI, I had the opportunity to have a lot of dialogue and debates and studies relating to strengthening of national agriculture research system, involving also in the process ISNAR and Dr. H.K. Jain, and also people like Pramod Joshi and IFPRI. We have noticed that other countries, though copied ICR model, like Pakistan Agriculture Research Council, Bangladesh Agriculture Research Council, Council for Agriculture Research and Policy in Sri Lanka, and even Philippine Council of Agriculture Research for Development called PICARD, they were all created on the model of ICR. But somehow they could not attain that kind of stature because of lack of political will, and could also not have consolidated approach for the three pillars of agricultural growth, that is the education, research, and extension. In that process, I would like to bring to your kind notice that it was in 1968 that ICR was reformed. Though ICR was established as early as 1929, at that time Imperial Council, as a society, it is still a society, and society was created to make it more independent in terms of its functions and decision-making process. And later, all institutions working on agriculture research, irrespective of whether in other ministries or even Ministry of Agriculture, were brought in the umbrella of ICR. And in 1968, the reorganized ICR was then brought under one umbrella and headed by the then Director General Dr. B.P. Paul, with whom I had opportunity to again work when he was Director IRI, but then he got elevated, and that was the time when the structural changes started taking place. And then after just 4 years, in 1972, Dr. Swaminathan became the Director General, and not only Director General, but a Department of Agriculture Research and Education was created, and he was also accorded the status of Secretary to the Government of India. This made all the difference, and this many of these other councils could not achieve, though they have been working and striving for it for decades now, but many times education is dealing with them, with the Ministry of Education. Many a times universities are separate from the councils, and many a times extension is not under their umbrella, even to talk of frontline extension as we have in ICAR. So this system grew. This system grew to the extent that today we have almost 105 ICR institutions. We have also 74 state agricultural universities. The last central agricultural university was only inaugurated last week by Honorable Prime Minister in Bundelkhand, Central Agricultural University. Now we have three of them. There are deemed universities. We started with actually deemed university status to begin with, and then came up with the state agricultural university. And therefore, it is rather necessary for me to brief you about what has happened and how this whole system has become resilient and vibrant today and serving the cause. And if the institutions had not been there, I'm sure we would not have achieved all what we have achieved today. And having our head high with the pride that we can take care of our problems very successfully, despite the constraints of all kinds that we have with us and which are all the time emerging before us. So, as I said, ICR was established even during pre-independence times. So the importance of that was also recognized by the Britishers, and the Royal Commission of Agriculture recommended to have Imperial Council of Agriculture Research, which became a part of Agriculture Ministry as a small department. It is going to celebrate 90th year next year. So it has matured also. Maybe it is twice the age of that of NAM now, but at the time of independence, if we go by the history and look at, we only had the 17 colleges and institutions in agriculture. And maybe you are aware that the first college on agriculture was established in 1877 in Coimbatore. So Coimbatore is the founding institution for agricultural education as far as India is concerned. Then the Imperial Veterinary Research Institute was created in 1889. So IVRI is the oldest institution in the ICR system, and it was created in Pune. Then it was shifted to Mukteshwar, and then now it is in Aijatnagar. Many people may not be knowing these histories, and that's why I'm trying to narrate it. Because on foundation days, we should try to know how we have founded all these institutions and served the national system. IRI, which is popularly known as Pusa Institute, and I hope you know why it is called Pusa Institute, because the philanthropist Henry Phillips, Henry Phipps, I would say, P-H-I-P-P-S, who donated all his earnings to have the institution established, and in Pusa, and he donated all his income and made sure that this institution in Pusa is established as Imperial Agriculture Research Institution at that time, which then got shifted to New Delhi. And it was established in 1905. Its PG school was then later on, after independence, established based on Indo-US mission on education headed by Ralph Cumming, who then became first dean of the PG school. Then it was made a postgraduate school and given the deemed university status. And that was the beginning of initiation of agriculture universities, in a sense, from institution to also attach the educational responsibility. And NDRI was established in 1923 in Bangalore, but then later on was shifted to Karnal. Now, when we look at, we see that the Ralph Cumming Indo-American team also recommended the establishment of state agricultural universities on land grant system. So land grant system was adopted based on American education system, adopting this semester system and of education, having the three functions of education, research and extension under the same umbrella. And the first university, what we call is the first state agricultural university on land grant system, was established in November 1960 at Pantanagar. Since then, we have now 74, we have grown. So in last 60 years, having 74, 75 universities is a long journey. And in the process, we also found that at that time, USAID helped a great deal and asked three institutions in the US, particularly the Illinois, which had adopted Pantanagar and Jabalpur, and then Ohio, which adopted Ludhiana and Udaipur. That time, these were only five universities, and Missouri, Bhubaneswar. And they had the institutional backstopping role, training role. Many of the teachers were sent to the US for getting trained there and came back and started serving Indian system. Now, when we look at the land grant system itself, and for even NARM, which is the 45th foundation, and land grant system 60 years, it's a time for introspection. I think on a foundation day, while we should be happy with the achievements in the past of these institutions, we should also avail this opportunity to have an introspection and see whether there is any need for mid-course correction, whether there is any need for organization and management reform, or even for educational reforms, and see what more can be done by readjusting. And it is in this context I had written only recently a book, Reorienting Indian Agriculture, because time has come that we should try to have an open mind to see what more can be done to reorient, to meet the needs of our challenges in future. In that respect, there had been many reviews. Unfortunately, the land grant system has not been reviewed. And therefore, our education system would require a critical look. NARM had done a great service by organizing Agriculture Science Congress in Bhubaneswar few years back, when agricultural education system was reviewed, and Dr. R.B. Singh has come out with very nice recommendations, where many our peers from abroad had also participated. But it seems that there is need to have a critical look with regard to our land grant system. But coming to NARM, we have definitely been having the advantage of various QRTs from time to time. And today it has become a unique institution serving the cause of human resource development, especially including the research management system. And it is comparable in many ways now with the Lal Bahadur National Academy of Administration in Missouri for IAS people. And RAS, thanks again to the visionaries and to Dr. Swaminathan, my hats off to him, to have started and given the stature to our agriculture researchers and scientists, that they can today compare themselves to the best services in the country, whether it is administrative, or whether it is police services, or whether it is allied services and whatnot. In this context, NARM has matured, has grown, has taken new responsibilities from time to time, which you all know. I need not repeat those, but it is heartening, which Dr. Srinivas Rao just recently mentioned, that NARM has been now allocated a responsibility to act as think tank. I think accepting the responsibility as think tank is very good, but to serve as think tank would require definite restructuring and rethinking, and even doing business differently than what we have been doing in the past. And that's what I am going to talk to you on in today's deliberation. And then ICR also constituted a committee and Dr. J.C. Katyal to provide some recommendations as to how this think tank can function. And Dr. Srinivas Rao also seemed to have organized a workshop, what they call is a scoping workshop, which is very relevant and very timely, because for doing anything new, we must do a scoping study. And we must try to understand our strengths and weaknesses, and also the opportunities and threats. So SWOT analysis must be for us. And that's what we try to do. Even when I was with ICR and joined, the first thing was to start with, those were the days, you know, when we were in mid-90s, late mid-90s, addressing the concern for 2020. So 25 years ahead, we started thinking and asked every institution, including ICR and all universities, to come up with Vision 2020 document. Now is the time that we have a relook, and I understand many institutions have come up with Vision 2030 documents, but when many a times I try to compare their achievements and actions and look at the vision document, there is a real mismatch to a greater extent. So whether we are working according to the vision that we have put in place for us, or whether we are doing according to the ease of doing business, which is more convenient and less pain-taking. For any change, change is must, but change is difficult. This is what I have been all the time talking about. But for any change, the resistance is the biggest problem, and resistance from within. And that, I think, is because we generally would like to have easy going rather than taking difficulties, challenges, pains. And when you do something, you are definitely answerable for your actions, and you must be transparent, and you must be put to test. And for that, you must have that, you know, courage to come forward and do that. So I presume for becoming the think tank, there are other think tanks like National Academy of Agriculture Research Office. Now Pramod Joshi is fortunately the secretary, and Dr. Mahapatra is the chairman. We would certainly like that NARM tries to align with the activities of NAS and also organization like TAS. Trust is also working for policy advocacy and public awareness. And what is required as a think tank to make sure that we influence policies at first charge. No doubt, other reforms in the system also to be addressed and thought of. But how can we influence policies so that we need and get all the support that we need? And in that respect, we have to become a foresight institution. Foresight is not easy. Let me also tell you, under Global Forum on Agriculture Research and also in partnership with CGIAR, we had organized the global conferences on agriculture research for development, and foresight was kept up front. And then we realized that foresight is necessary, is important. We have to be futuristic. We must think ahead, and we must try to reorient ourselves to achieve those. Like what we did when we started organization and management reform in ICR, we thought, let there be a mechanism by which these reforms are brought in. And I will come to those later. And then the mechanism we brought in was a National Agriculture Technology Project, an ambitious project ever funded by World Bank. But that was a project drawn by us to make a difference and make a change in what we are doing. And generally it is said, you can make a change when there is funding support. By advice like Niti Aayog today, Planning Commission used to allocate funds before, people were more serious to listen. Now you only advise, and for advice alone, possibly unless it is supported, Planning Commission recommended doubling of resources for agriculture research for ICR in the 12th plan, but then it has never happened. In last 7 to 8 years, it is only incremental increase with only 10 to 11% of allocation for these institutions for research. You can imagine what is the status currently and the challenges before us. So I would therefore say that to begin with, let NAM have a strong foresight division, and it not be guided by only its own faculty, but let it have an advisory group of peers drawn from within this country or even from abroad. And we have many experts who are maybe NRI, but are interested in helping Indian agriculture research system. The other point is that NAM must be globally wise, but act locally. And I think this is what Srinivas Rao rightly stated in his address, that we need to be globally aware of what is happening and what we can do. So when you look at foresight, there are two publications, one from the ISPC of CGIAR, is a Council for Science and Partnership. And it has come out with a very good book released only a year back on foresight issues in terms of what we should think of 2030 and maybe what we should think of 2050. So one is the mid course and one is the long-term strategy. And then there is also a World Bank document on foresight, which also is quite relevant in terms of how we have to reorganize ourselves to address sustainable development goals, climate change, and also issues relating to even COVID-19, which is now flagging before the world community. And recently we have released an open letter signed by almost more than 250 eminent people, including many prime ministers, leaders of the different national systems, Nobel laureates, the World Food Laureates, including Dr. Swaminathan, Dr. Serigaldin, also Padma awardees. And this is an open letter to UN and G20 and NASA that we need to prepare ourselves for long-term food security around the existing food systems and diversify our food basket and ensure availability of food where it is needed. Many countries are going to face problems, but fortunately India, with the buffer stock of 50 million tons, I'm sure for 2 years we can take care of ourselves, even if we have to face the situation of COVID-19 like what we are having today. We have to prepare ourselves for Paris Agreement, which we are signatory to. We can't shy away with it. And in that, again, we have to see what we have to do as agriculturists. And in that respect, it is reducing the use of fossil fuel. India seemed to be doing well, generating also other resources, fuel or the solar energy to be doing well, but on carbon sequestration, we seem to be behind. And we will not be able to achieve it unless we try to lay greater focus now on sustainable agriculture, conservation agriculture, and agroforestry. So I don't want to go into greater details, but I would like to say that in India, our problems, when we are with G card, came out very clearly. The messages were that we have to now lay our focus and shift it from the big farmers to smallholder farmers, and 80% of them in our country. So we have to address the concerns of smallholder farmers. That's what government is also talking about. And that's why we want to increase or double their income. Hopefully we will be able to do that, but would require various support and policies and policy reforms, which seem to have started lately. And in the process, we have also to see that we go in for diversification of agriculture, not crop and commodity oriented research we seem to be having so far. And even the Economic Survey of India had critically analyzed and said that green nation was cereal centric and probably more exploitationist approach, where we depended more on costly inputs. But probably for sustainability, we require diversification around other crops and commodities. And even we have to go in for other sectors like livestock and forestry and fishery and whatnot, or horticulture. So we have to also think not only the production part, we have to now think of post-production part. And for post-production part, I think academia has to now think very clearly as to how you can add value, how you can have post-production management, and how can you link farmers to market, and how can you bring in entrepreneurship, and how can you have changes in educational system, which is otherwise generally a formal system, to produce white-collar job-oriented graduates. Can we go in for vocational training? That's what recent education policy is now highlighting. Even they are highlighting that agriculture should be taught at a school level, which we have been asking for quite long. And I'm glad this is now being recognized. And we have to also see that there is greater emphasis on vocational training and informal training, and more incubators, more programs for entrepreneurship. And NARM already has moved ahead and has one of the best incubation facilities that I have seen. It's serving a great call. I will come to it also a little later, but we have to address the concerns of some of the people who are talking about our national agriculture research system today, like chief economic advisor to the government through his economic survey, Dr. Arvind Subramanian, in 2015 and 2016, had said that only 63% of agriculture scientists, in fact, are only 33 to 35% scientists are performing, whereas the others are in the poor, very poor category. Now, how these figures have come, someone has to analyze and be more realistic. But maybe they have come from somewhere, if our chief economic advisor is talking about it, and also putting it in the Economic Survey of India. When you talk to industrialists, the big industrialists, person like Ajay Sriram of DCM had recently indicated that public research system has tended to operate in isolation. So can we have partnership with private sector? Why do we treat private sector as alien? If they are also serving the cause of the smallholder farmers and helping in increasing the farmers' income and production and productivity for the country. Recently, Dr. Ramesh Chand from Niti Aayog, while addressing the Indian Economics Association in 2019, also had made certain statements, which I think must draw our attention. And I hope it already is drawing attention of many of you, that that public R&D system in agriculture is having a fatigue. Is it true? Also, that there are no new innovations. Otherwise, they would have picked up and scaled up at their own, like Green Revolution, where we had miracle seeds, which made the impact. And there is fragmentation. Of course, that fragmentation is taking place. University is getting bifurcated into different disciplines. Agriculture has to be holistic. How can you say it is the University of Animal Science and then I'm training agricultural graduates? The lack of drive and poor efficiency of our production system. That also is a cause. We have to improve efficiency because we have to be globally competitive. If tomorrow we have to export and take benefit of globalization, then that part also has to be properly addressed and taken note of. And in that context, the education policy has also recently said that state agriculture universities, with all the investment that has been made and good infrastructure that has been created and good human resource, I think at national level now, agriculture scientists is the second largest with 35 to 37,000 the scientists and educationists involved. But this is only training around 1% of human resource in the country compared to the rest of the educational institutions and universities. So is it underutilized or can we do more to train more? Or do we have to train only the white collar job oriented graduates, or can we go in for the industrial training like not IITs but ITIs, or can we also think of having entrepreneurs and think of new models like agri clinics, etc., are the issues which should draw attention. So having said all this and given this as a background, I would like to now come to the main point that under this scenario, with the new challenges, second generation problems of Green Revolution, factor productivity decline, I don't want to go into all those details, over exploitation of natural resources, reduced income of farmers, less of opportunities to link with the market and so on. But then what NARM should do? There can be many areas. I'm going to give you a big list, but you will have to work on it and reprioritize and see what really will meet your capabilities and expectations, and what are the priorities which can deliver first, and maybe others can be taken later on. First, as I earlier said, it must have a strong foresight division with an advisory group of peers. Second, it must help the national system and ICR. For us also, NCAP was very helpful that time. Thanks to Dr. Dayanath Jha, Dr. Mrityunjay, Dr. Pramod Joshi, even Ramesh Chand, and we involved even Suresh Pal, we involved that time to look for vision. And this vision cannot be through individual initiative or effort by only few. So you require an approach to put in vision documents, which have to be active. And for that, it has to be short-term and long-term. So maybe 2030 and 2050, and not only for yourself, but for all institutions which are involved, including even those new institutions which got created since 1950. 30 of them were created even during my time itself. And if they had not been created, possibly we had to create today. Because if there is no institutional base, if there is no research on banana, how India can be number one banana producing country? If there is no institute on grape, how can you be a grape exporter today? I don't want to go in all those details, but you needed them. You needed vegetable institute. And that's how now today you see what kind of growth that is taking place. And you needed institution for soybean. You needed institution for rapeseed mustard. And today you are having highest growth rates in those crops. You have to also think in terms of what is required to be done to reorient our agenda while resources are limited and while cadre strength is also limited. So cadre review is another area in which we can help. I understand ICR has undergone cadre review only recently. We did it in before 2020. And that time how we created in social science 100 positions by reallocating the human resource from available institutions and in the sanctioned strength. So we have to also think, and because needs will go on changing, and whether we are addressing those changing needs, the other important point is, have we made the national agriculture research system in true sense a national agriculture research and innovation system? Innovation is a buzzword, and those institutions, those countries, those organizations which have not taken benefit and have upstream and outscaled the innovations, they have lagged behind. And therefore, we must think of innovation. Our emphasis should go not on science-oriented research for scientists' own career advancement, but for innovation which can help the end user. And for that, we have to go for disruptive innovation, about which Mashelkar has talked in his book recently, Leapfrogging to Pole Vaulting. I hope you might have read, many of you, is an excellent book, that we don't want leapfrogging now. We want pole vaulting. And for you need a new idea, and ideas like disruptive innovation, like smartphone, which is helping not only rich people, but also the poor people. And you can disseminate your information to any level. So the philosophy should be more from less for more. And in agriculture, we have been doing it since beginning. We are producing more from less, few seeds, more production, and more people to be benefited for their food security. So we in fact have been having innovations right from beginning. Miracle seeds, what you call dwarf seeds. Now we have also GM cotton. But why there is hesitation for other similar technologies, if they are available and can help the farmer, are the issues which require our attention. Then we have to see how can we change our research agenda to become farmer and farming systems oriented. And how can we put farmer first? We have been telling in India, Bharat Krishi Pradhan Desh hai, But we have not made the farmer first. So when we will, I'm glad the government is now at least emphasizing the importance of it and trying to come forward with some new innovative idea. So what we require in future and where NARM has to help is the helping the agriculture research agenda to reorient around diversification, eco-regional planning, translational research, inter-institutional collaboration, which is a big, big hurdle. We are enjoying our own empires. To tell you frankly, when I started bringing in organization management reforms, it was not easy. Under NATP, then we said, if the institutions not collaborate with each other, we will not fund. And that was one way of. So inter-institutional collaboration. Eco-regional, only irrigated system got benefited. But what about rainfed? It's still 55% area. What about the mountain and hill region? What about coastal? So we started the eco-regional programs and started competitive research grant system. And that research grant system today is not there in ICR system, unfortunately. We had under PL480 before, we had under NATP, by which the good projects could be funded, which were interinstitutional, interdisciplinary, mission-oriented, which delivered results, and which linked the farmers to villages, IVLP, and which had Atma role for KVK. Unfortunately, both have been now bifurcated. So we started with some good things, but then we started again building our own umbrella and empire. And we have forgotten after what we started. So maybe we have to have a relook at some of these reforms we started with. We started with incentives and reward. You cannot do well unless you have incentives linked to the performance. And that's why JOL committee was instituted and we approved those and the reward system was brought in. They are already in existence, but when you go to institutions and ask for why the performers are not being incentivized, I don't find answers. It means there is something lacking somewhere in terms of implementation. So sometimes even good initiatives, if not properly implemented, good strategy, good programs would not help you much. So the other important point which academy means NARM, should definitely think of, I think, I would be taking another 5 to 10 minutes. I hope you will bear with me. This, how can we make our scientists accountable? Now, you saw what Arvind had stated, the performance is poor. How can you assess and make it sure that everyone start performing? I think accountability and a system for assessment for accountability through output, through the impact is an important task. And maybe much is required to be done in this regard, which we seem to have not addressed. It is good, everyone should get promoted. I would not deny, but for that one should perform as well. Without performance, expecting 95 to 97% people getting promoted is, I think, something worrisome. One must think in that context as well. So for accountability, we have to bring in transparency in the assessment system. And how is the assessment system? Now we have to change it. Under ASRB committee, which I headed, we had to recommend that all assessment should be centralized through ASRB, not at certain level at institute and at other level at ASRB. And so that there is uniformity of standard and procedures. And also, we need to revisit the score system. And the score system should be not only for scientists' own benefit. Now, research, many people even argue that all research being done today is scientist-oriented, not the need-oriented. In the process, we also have to look at what kind of indicators for assessment for outputs and impact can be more refined. In fact, we have been playing with the scorecard rather unnecessarily for quite long. So we have to streamline this system and put a process in system, not that everybody's will by anybody, anytime, because this is not correct or this doesn't suit certain individual, you try to change it. We have to therefore be more realistic, more pragmatic, and more transparent. And for that, academies have to come forward and provide required guidelines. Coming then in terms of use of new science and reorienting agriculture research, curriculum adjustment. Now you go abroad, you don't find often even in the College of Agriculture being named as College of Agriculture. I went to days with Dr. Gurdev Khush, where he is adjunct professor and had served before and living there. I said, you please take me to your division where you had worked. He said, sorry, Raj, there is no such division anymore. They have all been reformed. Now, College of Agriculture, you go, it is College of Food Science and Technology. So the issue of post-production is getting linked to production side. So I don't want to go into all those details, but there are ample examples. There are no home science colleges there now, but we are happy to continue with what we started with. Would never like to change. If we started a division, we would never like to change. If we started with any specific discipline, we in ARS committee, which also I headed, recommended the closure of certain divisions or disciplines. They have not been closed. We said there should be uniformity for semester and trimester system of education. It has not been brought in. So I think there is some resistance somewhere. Why it is, I think one has to start looking and can this resistance be broken or addressed and people brought on common platform to have common agenda is an issue which should look into. And for new science, now people are talking of robotics, drones, artificial intelligence, nanotechnology. We don't have competitive research grant, and therefore I would say, let us try to learn from what even other institutions are doing. Now I am reviewing currently the BIREC program of Department of Biotechnology. Every year funding through competitive research grant more than 400 to 500 crores, which is quite a big program. And the program is to encourage entrepreneurs to come up with ideas and to become successful entrepreneurs and serve the system through the public-private partnership. Now that's the kind of thing which is needed, but do we have it? If not, why not? We should have it is an issue which should draw our attention. I have already talked about land grant system of education, but now see the mushrooming of universities, that is one part, but mushrooming of agriculture colleges. In one state, hundreds of colleges being created without any minimum norms being followed. So why not we think of having an agricultural education council like Veterinary Council of India and make sure that there is accreditation system linked to any approval for creating any new institution college or university. We started with the accreditation system, but that accreditation system also, Dr. Agarwal is participating in this meeting, would require real strengthening. And I'm glad that a national higher education project by World Bank is already there. This is an opportunity to bring in reforms in education sector. Why people don't follow Model Act in the university? Why we have not switched over? Why we have not improved our practical experience? When people said that there is no practical experience for agriculture graduates, when I was in ICR, we had to start at our own cost, funding by ICR, the rural agriculture work experience of 6 months linked to all universities. We also brought in the program of scholarship linked to the switching over of students from one university to another to take care of inbreeding. And that's how the movement started, but there was great resistance. People even at the railway stations not allowed to get down. At one of the university whom we had sent after selecting at national level with scholarship. So you have to really see that bringing change is not easy, but bringing change is must for future growth and progress. Without that, we will be where we are today. Now, also there is need for reforms in agricultural extension system. Now, today, our agricultural extension system is not able to provide the kind of knowledge and services to the farmers for the secondary specialty or you know, even farming system oriented programs and production system. So can we bring in private sector? Can we bring in youth? Can we train them? Can we make sure that there is private extension? When for my field in my village, I asked a person in village to bring his tractor along with his seed drill to do sowing for me in just 1 hour time without any investment for keeping the entire infrastructure at high cost. When you have these kinds of services available, why not more of these services? So agriculture input agents, agriculture extension knowledge providers, even the ethics centers, which were created during that time to make sure that whatever we produce is available to the end user. But if you don't produce and you don't give, then how it will reach to the end user? And many institutions which started with very good ethic programs, I have visited few. I don't want to criticize or name them, but I can tell you they have become now a routine affair. That is not required. What we need is a mission board to deliver and to deliver any good product that we have so that it is available for not only increasing his own income, but also helping the national system to have higher productivity and production. I have talked about O&M reforms. We need a model like NATP. Maybe Academy and ICR think of negotiating again with whether World Bank or Asian Development Bank or Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. And there are many options available, or like even government. When Department of Biotechnology can have a competitive research grant of 400 to 500 crores annually, why can't we? And why can't we have another project through World Bank and see that in the process, all these reforms are taken care of? Then the National Academy has also to serve ASRB. ASRB also as an important institution for backstopping concerning new dimensions of For my evaluation, I have talked assessment linked to transparency. I have talked reforms in the interview process. Even our committee had recommended two-tier system for interview for higher research management positions. It has been not yet implemented. 2 years have passed. How long will it take and why should we have resistance? No doubt it will require a new system and setup of working. But for that, unless we move forward, we will always be just saying that in all international organizations, for any good positions, the two-tier system is in operation. How can you judge appointment of a director today if the faculty of that institution has not even seen him and he has spoken to them and given them his idea as to what he sees as his vision for the institution for next 5 years when he will be director? Can in 1 hour interview we can decide all this? I think there are issues, and for that maybe we need to have much more serious thinking. I already talked resistance to change. ICR has been reviewed not once, more than 10 times. Started Gajendra Gadkar committee, GVK Rao, Dr. MS Swaminathan, Dr. Mashelkar, Dr. Ramasamy. Even I have given for many programs, KVK, Agriculture Research Service, ASRB. Recently, Dr. Gautam has given for reforming the All India Coordinated Research Projects. Now, we have to see whether these committees have been taken into cognizance and at least the good recommendations, which are in the interest of organizational growth, have been implemented. Maybe there are certain reservations within, and maybe there are reservations outside, above even, for policy support. Like, you know, in ICR, it was made a society. Gajendra Gadkar report has very categorically stated that it should be independent in terms of its own resource allocations. But we have not come out of the clutches of finance ministry. I had myself been chairing AFCs, though I had my own way to deal with and move ahead and created whatever we wanted, but it was not easy. And therefore, you need to bring in a system by which we can act more conveniently, efficiently, and transparently to serve the system to maybe give much better output and benefits to the nation. Even academy can be a repository. To tell you frankly, I talked about those all review committees. Today you don't find them all on the website of ICR. What can you do? From where do you get this information? And even I have talked to some of the chairmen that can you provide a copy, and they said, sorry, we don't have. So if that is the state of affairs, then I think there is something serious which will have to be thought of. So whether National Academy of Agriculture Research Management can be a repository of all this information. I talked to you about historical development of National Agriculture Research System. People will not know under whose time NBPGR was created. It was Dr. Swaminathan when he was director, and Dr. Joshi when he was dean, and Dr. Harbhajan Singh was the head of the division of plant introduction division. It was created, but where is this history? Only one has to go to that institute, but this is ICR history. So we have to think, even there are, Agriculture Commission report, Mirdha Commission report. I do not know how many have read and seen those, and how many have even seen Dr. Swaminathan Farmers Commission reports. Even I am at loss when I sometimes go to and visit any institution or KVK. My KVK reports has also not reached KVKs. So they just don't know what has been recommended, and maybe then they are, whatever happens, whatever is implemented, then the responsibility is on the chair of that committee. He might have recommended this kind of reform. So you require a historical perspective of evolution of NARS to be put at one place. And I think that can be a great service and will be a great service in the whole system as a whole. And I already mentioned about reforms in the research management cadre. We recommended that academy should have a special focus, not only foundation course, but also on the RMP course for mid course and for the senior level management. Even at a higher level, when I was heading a program for the World Bank for Central Asia and Caucasus of 8 countries, along with two director generals of ICR, we were sent to Harvard for a 15-day reorientation course in agriculture research management. And I can tell you, it was an eye-opener. We thought we have done a lot of reform. We have managed it, and we possibly have accomplished something. But such kind of academies, such kind of Harvard institution, Stanford, Oxford, we need to see that we tomorrow build some of these universities, institutions also like Harvard and Oxford. Today, NIRF, what you call is National Institution Research Ranking Framework. There are only 6 universities from agriculture which are coming in the top 100 universities in the country. But none at the global level. And I went to Western Australia University headed by an Indian, Dr. Kadambod Siddiq. I was so happy that that is the best institution in Australia today in agriculture. And among the top 10 agricultural schools in the world, Wageningen, Cornell, Illinois, you talk of some of them, and we have Ohio, and learn from them as to how they are functioning and what reforms they have brought in. And who can do this? Now, recently, Dr. Srinivas Rao said that he, along with some team of his people, could go and see. So seeing is believing. But then when you see, come back and implement. So be globally alert, but act locally. I saw the best gene bank in the world, but when I came back, I was miserable. And then said, we'll not have rest unless we have our own gene bank in place. We need to do it. And who else is going to do? Nobody is going to give us in silver plate. And then finally, I'm going to say that we must come forward to build this partnership between public and private system. And this is on periphery for saying, for the sake of saying it is there, but it is not functioning and it is not successful. We must make it a successful. We must make sure that there is trust, there is mutual respect, and there is sharing of benefits. And this is built from right from beginning. And then we have success stories around which can be replicated. And we must therefore encourage entrepreneurs right from beginning and bring in them forward. And therefore the Maya concept, which we have from TAS trying to propagate and popularize, is a concept which has to be thought of, where agri-clinics can be linked with each KVK. You don't have to new institution, but you provide these guys a building for which they will pay the rent, but they will provide you all the people around the best knowledge, best services, like what you get in polyclinic for any of your ailment when you go there. I have already mentioned about incentive reward. How can we have those rewards more implemented? And my last issue for consideration is coordination and convergence is the biggest gap. We have recommended this also in our recent report to the Government of India through Principal Scientific Advisor, Dr. Vijay Raghavan, on policies for secure and sustainable agriculture. This we have said that agriculture is a state subject, and most of the support is going from center. And then in education also, you give a lot of funds to the university. But ICAR directives are never listened. Even for the selection of their RMP positions or even vice chancellors, ICAR is not involved in many states. Rather, they would try to avoid it. And they have changed their model acts sometimes to do it. So there is a resistance, and great resistance. But then this has to be thought of. We need a coordination and convergence mechanism. We need convergence with the CSIR, DST, UGC, DBT, DRDO, with the, our former president, Dr. Abdul Kalam, when he was chief of the DRDO. I was heading the ICAR. Mashalkar was heading the CSIR. And we had regular coordination meetings every 6 months. Once chaired by ICR DG and once chaired by the DG of other organization. And all senior people participated, and we had very active collaboration. We need these kinds of reorganizations to be brought in again. So finally, I would say that much is there. You can only decide to chew which you can only eat, but we have put before you, or rather I have tried to put before you different acts in the basket. It is for you to select as to what best would serve your purpose to become a think tank, to serve not only ICR. Let me say, don't only think of serving ICR, you have to think of serving National Agriculture Research System. And to make it innovation system. So NARIS, from NARI to NARS to NARIS, involving all the three pillars of education, research, and extension is the challenge. It is a timely challenge, and I'm happy you have accepted it, and you have already started moving in this direction, but you would definitely need a different reorientation and more aggressive approach if you need to work. And while working, make sure that you don't duplicate, and work in partnership also with academies, other science academies, INSA, NAS, NASI, TAS, and so on. And I'm sure NAM will continue being recognized as one of the best institutions in the system. Let me just tell you one thing. At the fag end of my career in ICAR, a delegation of 10 countries, heads of their agriculture research system from Africa had come. And they were taken around, and that was facilitated by, again, USAID that time. And they were taken around to various institutions and also to NAR. And in the wrap-up meeting, when we were discussing, I just inquired that you had a good opportunity of seeing our institutions, including some leading universities. Kindly tell me, what did impress you most? And the answer was, the most impressive institution I have come across is your NARM institution. So you should be proud of. They said other institutions are doing similar things, but NARM is doing something else and training the future leaders for the national system. And we would like our middle research managers and the senior research managers to be sent here for training. That is an opportunity. And NARM should think outside India. And I think I should close with this happy note. Thank you, Dr. Srinivas Rao, Dr. Som, and all faculty members for giving me this opportunity. I hope I have exceeded the time limit, but probably this was unavoidable. Thank you very much. Hello.
Yes, sir. Just
hello. I hope I was audible and you could listen to me, or there was some break.
Yes, sir. It was
no. It's very, very nice, sir. Very audible.
Hello.
Sir,
are you able to listen to me?
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir, for your very, very engaging and then insightful thoughts. And you are simply irresistible as the thoughts and then ideas were flowing into your mind. And then you have simply, as you rightly ended, like we have, our baskets are full of ideas now. And actually, you took us through a long journey, like the sectoral issues, the major milestones of ICR, and then to address those challenges as a think tank, what ICR, that is particularly NARM, should be doing, like in terms of restructuring, the way that we think, thinking process, bringing in worldview, and building our competencies in terms of research of foresight, and particularly various areas of research. And then you touched upon almost all live subjects that we should be focusing on, sorry. Particularly then when you talked about disruptive innovation, we recognize like it is a dual role for us, like not only to pilot and then do disruptive innovation, but also to understand what takes to do this disruptive innovation and then build those competencies among our fraternity as well, like the entire NARAS. So talk on such a heavy topic like think tank for reorienting Indian agriculture, who better than you, sir? Like you have been an embodiment of think tank by yourself. Like, thank you so much for your entire time. And certainly this pandemic has denied us the luxury of hosting you physically over here amidst us. But kindly accept our felicitations, sir, like very soon, once the situation normalizes, we look forward to a very valid occasion, as well as a time to have you amidst us and then build on your ideas further, sir. Like, thank you so much. Thank you so much, sir. Like, now I request our Joint Director, Dr. S.K. Som, to propose a formal vote of thanks.
I, on the behalf of the Director NARM and the NARM family, take this opportunity to thank all the dignitaries and the participants because of which this program was highly successful. First of all, I am thankful to the Honorable Chief Guest of today's function, Dr. R.S. Baroda, for giving the wonderful talk on this and also the insight to all of us. Sir, thank you very much for your very innovative talk. And I can remind that one of our NARM friend, Dr. S.M. Virmani, now he is no more, and he used to say that why do we celebrate Foundation Day? Then he said that you know your roots, remind your mandate, revise your direction, and foresight. And sir, the all of the things you have covered, and especially the takeaway for us, one is that accountability of service, which you spoke, and another is that incentivization. So sir, we'll start immediately to work upon those two things, at least immediately. We are thankful to our RAC chairman, Dr. Padmanabhan. he just left just 5 minutes before only. Otherwise, continuously he was within the program. I'm thankful on behalf of NAM to him. We are also thankful to our Honorable Deputy Director General, Dr. R.C. Agarwal Saab. He was continuously in the program. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. We are also thankful to our former directors, those online, they were available. Dr. Joshi, even Dr. Elias was also there, and Dr. Ramara, physically, he's with us. We are also thankful to all the several vice chancellors, those who were in the program and attending it, and also to the fellows of NAS and also the fellows of NASI, those who are attending this this function. I am personally thankful to all the heads of the divisions at NAM, those who have contributed a lot for success of this program by this Foundation Day celebration committee. So I'm thankful to Dr. Sontaki, Dr. Senthil Vinayagam, Dr. RBS Rao, Dr. Ranjit, and Dr. Sekar, and also to the Joint Director Administration, and also the Chief Finance and Account Officer, those also who are the member of this particular committee. There was a subcommittee also for identifying different kind of awards. I'm thankful to them. Dr. Sontaki was the chairman of one committee, Dr. P. Ramesh and Dr. G.R.K. Muthi. Sir, the seniors like you, they always teach us that find out the opportunities, look for the opportunities in the difficulty. This is a difficult period, the COVID one. But we have found out the opportunity within this, and we can say that around 600 people are watching this program. Earlier, we used to do this program physically, and normally around 300 people used to attend this when you were also there 3 years, 3 years before in the Foundation Day, around same people. But this time, around 600 people are watching through Zoom and through YouTube. And this could have been possible because of our wonderful and innovative team, Dr. Dandapani, Mr. K.V. Kumar, Mr. Arun, Mr. Naresh, all those people, those who made it possible. The physical arrangements done by Dr. Vijender Reddy, Dr. Lakshman Ahire, Shri Mohan Singh, Shri Shekhar Reddy, and Shri Shyam Bahadur, all the senior technical officers and the chief technical officers, those who contributed a lot for this. And we are also thankful to Mr. Ravi, Mr. Shivaji to take the beautiful pictures for this. And I, my own behalf, congratulate all the award winners, and also on the behalf of the management, congratulate them again for the wonderful work they have done. Not only that last financial year, but continuously they are doing the good work, and also they will be doing the good work in the coming years also. And because of this, situation of the COVID, we also could see that people, those who retired, for example, Dr. Krishnan M. Krishnan, the head of the division of the ESM, the retired last year, he was also attending from Chennai this program. And I could see my own friends, various directors, Dr. Gopal Lal, Dr. Rajbir Singh, Dr. Vaji Prasad, those who are continuously on Zoom, sir, they were doing this. And I, on the behalf of Director NAM, especially thankful to our Honorable Deputy Director General, because whatever the arrangement is done on Zoom, it is his courtesy. And he has permitted us to use the Zoom of the ICR office. Sir, many, many thanks. This was a very successful experiment. And to the Honorable Chairman, I want to submit that this your talk was going on wonderfully, and today the internet and YouTube was most wonderful. There was no break at all in the whole talk, and also the event. We are thankful to the God internet also that everything went very well. We are also thankful to our farmers and also our different kind, different zones, Ataris and the institutions, those who have nominated various farmers for this. In fact, this is the innovative initiative which has been taken by our Honorable Director since last year, that we honor even the farmers also, though we are not in direct touch with those farmers, but through the Atari, we used to do this activity. At the end, I am thankful to each and everyone. And I am especially thankful to the people sitting in this hall, because they are without water, without tea, 50% of the oxygen because of mask. Thank you very much to you all for the all success of this program. Thank you one and all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. So with this, we come to the close of our grand 45th Foundation Day. So I request all of you to rise for national anthem, please. Already it's late, but still just for 10 minutes our director decides to honor the awardees in front of director's office. I request for just for a brief gathering there. The awardees will be given the certificates by our director, please.